My name is Patricia Albjerg Graham, but most everybody who knows me calls me Pat or Pat Graham. I wrote a book a while ago called Schooling America, and in this book I argued that over the 20th century, our emphasis for what we wanted our schools to produce changed. And I think we've had four different emphases in the 20th century, and now in the 21st, I would say we're on to a fifth. But let me say a little bit about what those changing emphases have been. You've got to think about what the United States was like in 1900 and from 1900 until 1920. And the United States in that period, in many ways, was a lot like it is now, that we were a nation overwhelmingly of immigrants. Particularly in our large cities, there were big immigrant populations, and in some of our rural Midwestern areas, there were lots of immigrant farmers, including my grandparents. So I would say that from 1900 to 1920, when public education was just getting started, we were just beginning to get, 10% of our kids going to high school, that what we wanted our schools to do was to help those children assimilate as American citizens. We wanted them to learn how to be Americans. We thought it would be good for them, but even more, we thought it would be good for the country for them to be assimilated as American citizens. Furthermore, the curriculum for assimilation was the same for native-born American children as well as for immigrant children and the children of immigrants. The nature of that curriculum was mastering the English language, getting a decent grip on arithmetic, learning about American history and American traditions, and there was a little room left over, a tad of science. But the point was that it was a rigid curriculum which we pushed all these children through. Most of them didn't make it to high school. Most of them dropped out before high school, but they did have the rudiments of Americanism. Now by 1920, after World War I, from 1920 throughout the roaring 20s and through the Depression era of the 30s and in World War II in the 1940s, we were concerned that the rigidity which characterized the schools of the early years of the 20th century was not appropriate for the children of particularly of the affluent and of the professional classes. They didn't want their children locked up in these rigid environments. They were concerned about their children's adjustment, their psychological adjustment, their social adjustment. They were interested in their children's creativity. And for these children, they managed literacy and fundamental numeracy okay. But we worried that they would not be able to be creative or to have friends or to be able to do interesting activities in school, that they would be bored. And so we had a period of adjustment as the main goal of the school, helping children adjust to life. Well, by the 40s, when this adjustment curriculum was beginning to be quite broadly established, we were talking about adjustment to your station in life. And so we'd only believe then that about 20% of kids ought to be able to go to college. Only about 20% would have a vocational training in the schools. And the remaining 60% would have a curriculum that would help them adjust to life. And that typically meant adjust to the life and the station in life of their parents. So if their parents were working class, you had them adjust to a working class curriculum which didn't have foreign languages and didn't prepare them for more advanced education. That was a bad idea. By 1954, the third big change came. This is after World War II and after the passage of the GI Bill, in which sent many young men from working class backgrounds to college, which nobody in their family had ever done. By 1954, the federal government, which had never played an active role in education in the United States, began to get concerned about education. And the branch of the federal government that got concerned initially was the Supreme Court. And in 1954, the Supreme Court, in a decision called Brown versus Board of Education, declared segregation of schools by race unconstitutional. That was a big shock to the U.S. South, which had traditionally kept white students and black students in separate and determinedly unequal settings. And this action of the Supreme Court then became the third era, which talked about access. And the access issue, first of all, was the access of blacks to white schools, but which has had very mixed results. First, it was primarily in the South, then in the North, and it has not been phenomenally successful in terms of improving the educational opportunities of either black or white children, particularly black children. But the access issue was the one that recognized that schools in the United States were not doing as well in many instances as they ought to be. And so it was access to special programs, the desegregation program initially. Then it was access for the gifted and talented children to special programs for gifted and talented to foster the skills of the Americans so that they could keep up with the Russians who had just put a satellite into space in 1957, which the United States was unable to do. Then it was concern about access for children with various kinds of disabilities. So we got special programs for children with disabilities. We got a and then in the passage in 1965, the federal government's Elementary and Secondary Education Act, we got special programs for children who grew up in low-income families. And that 1965 Elementary and Secondary Education Act has been the basis for the education legislation up to the present time, which got the present time being several weeks ago, in which we eliminated No Child Left Behind and took the federal government significantly out of the educational business which it has been in for the last 20 years. So the access era ended in 1983 with the publication, again by the federal government, of the A Nation at Risk. And A Nation at Risk was essentially written by a group that had been in the National Institute of Education, the Education Research Division of the federal government, with a national panel reflecting diverse interests of the American public in education. And this 1983 document said, our nation was at risk because of our bad educational system. And the focus since 1983 up until quite recently has been on improving the academic content of the educational system of American children. But the fact of the matter is, we don't know how to do that. We simply do not know how to educate all children well, in large part because, unlike medicine or agriculture, we have not spent a lot of money on research in education, and we have not figured out how to improve educational practice. And I would say that the present new emphasis is on assessment. So that's really the fifth A in this string of A's that have characterized what we wanted to do in education. And the fifth A, assessment, has revealed to us in the various tests that we have given to American children that they are not as well educated as we would like them to be. Now, the question is, are these tests, in fact, good indicators of what it is children know and are able to do? That is the source of a great argument. But at the moment, we're still in the assessment argument in which we are trying to find out what the children know and are able to do, and we would like to be able to improve that. Thank you.